Today I want to revisit a passage. You ever read passages and they kind of speak in your heart and you kind of drift back to those? This is one of those. And I told Sandra this was what was kind of brewing while I was up there this week in the mountains camping. And I said, but I know I've also preached it. And so I looked. So if you were here in September of 17, you heard this same passage, not the same sermon, but I preached on the same passage. If you weren't here, good for you. This is all brand new. But one of the things that I love about reading through the New Testament and Jesus' teaching, of course, Jesus is the supreme teacher, the ultimate teacher, and he taught in several different ways, but two primary ways that Jesus taught and engaged people was one with parables, and there's tons of parables, and I like parables because parables kind of give a heavenly spiritual concept to an earthly, something I can grab a hold of and understand, like the sower sowing, that's a parable. The other way that he taught, and if you've done any teaching or studying thereof, you find he taught by questions. One of the greatest ways to teach is to ask people questions, because when someone poses a question to us and we have to wrestle inside with our own self and our mind, our understanding of what's going on. And so the two primary ways that he taught was one, parables, two, by question. Today I want to be looking at one of the most profound questions to me in Scripture. And it's just like earth-shattering, but it is amazing. If you have your Bibles open, we'll be in John chapter 5. We're going to be reading 15 verses, the first 15 verses. I'm going to just read the story, and then we'll go from there. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, a pool in Aramaic called Bethesda, which has five roofed colonnades. In these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm going, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, take your bed, and walk." And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and walked. Now, that day was the Sabbath, so the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful for you to take up your bed." But he answered them, "The man who healed me, that man said to me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" They asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk?'" Now the man who had been healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn as there was a crowd in the place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. A lot of interesting concepts in this story. A little bit of backstory, you may be familiar already, but the Pool of Bethesda is kind of a famous place, and there was you can call it a legend or whatever you want to call it, but at the Pool of Bethesda, there was a concept that every so often, an angel would come down and stir the water in the pool, and the first one in would be healed. The first person in the pool after the angel stirred the water. Now, you can ask me, did that really happen? I had no concept. All I know is that was the legend. That was why everybody gathered around the Pool of Bethesda. That's why it says there were so many invalids there. That's where they went, because their only hope at the time of being healed was to be the first one in the pool after the angel stirred the water, which makes sense when he says, "I have nobody to help me." He was an invalid. He's paralyzed. 38 years. 38 years he'd been paralyzed. I was thinking about that today. Me and Sandra have been married 38 years. It doesn't sound like that long, and some days it doesn't seem like that, but when you think about it, 38 years is a long time to be paralyzed, to be lame, to be an invalid, to be crawling yourself over. His only means of transportation was either to crawl, drag himself, or someone carry him on his bed. That's how he got around. 38 years he'd been going to the pool and been waiting for the opportunity that just maybe this time when the angel stirs the water, I can get in and finally be healed. So that's the backstory. Now Jesus comes along and he knows about the Pool of Bethesda. He knows all of this. He sees all of the invalids. Why he picks out this one guy, I don't know. God does what God does, right? But here's the interesting thing. The question. Did anybody catch the question? He says, do you want to be healed? He didn't ask him, how long have you been here? He didn't ask him, what is your problem? He said, do you want to be healed? You see, the interesting part of this question for me is this. Through all of the Bible, Jesus, and like I said, he talks about questions. He asks interesting questions. And let's just look at a few, and then we'll approach this one. He says, how do you see the speck in your brother's eye, but you don't notice that you have a beam in yours? Teaching question. How do you see what's wrong with everybody else, but you don't see what's wrong with you? He says, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, do you not think that the Father would give even better gifts? Interesting teaching question. If you think you're good, what about the Heavenly Father? Remember when they were out in the boat and the storm came up and they got all scared and he said, why are you fearful? Well, because it's storming and I'm in a boat in the middle of the lake. Yeah, but I'm here. Why are you fearful? Interesting question. Why do we let surrounding circumstances make us fearful? Interesting question. This is another one of my favorites. Blind Bartimaeus. You remember him? Blind Bartimaeus. He's sitting and he'd call out and he as Jesus was coming down, someone said, hey, Jesus, the healer's coming. And Bartimaeus cried out to him. Cried out to him. And what did he ask him? What can I do for you? Isn't that an interesting question to ask a blind man? He knows you're the healer, and Jesus asks him first, what do you want that I do for you? So questions are important. And Jesus asks questions not because he's confused or he doesn't know. He asks so that we will actually honestly look at ourselves and answer the question. So he asked this man at the Pool of Bethesda, do you want to be healed? Now that seems like a ridiculous question. Of course he does. 38 years he's been crawling. 38 years he's been waiting. 38 years all of his life he's been an invalid. Wouldn't we assume that he wants to be healed? The problem is, the first question he asks is, are you really willing to let me do something in your life? Are you really willing? Do you want to change? So he looks at the man and says, this has become your norm. You've accepted your circumstance. So if you're healed, then your life's going to be radically changed. Everything that you've known is going to be different. If you're able to get up and walk, then you're not going to be able to sit here and beg and people give you money. You're not going to be able to just do the same things you've been doing. Now you're going to have to get a job. Life's going to be different. You're going to have a whole different approach to life. The question that Jesus asked you and I think this is a fair question, as we're looking at life, he says, do you want your life to change? Do you really want it to change? We cry unto the Lord when life is a wreck, right? When everything's bad, we're in a job that we hate or a relationship that's falling apart or we've got health issues going on. We got all this stuff going on in life. And we come to the Lord and we say, Lord, help us, help us. We pray. We mention prayers all the time, right? We've got all these life things going on because life is real, isn't it? And life is painful. And we say, Lord, help. Lord, I need financial guidance. Lord, I need a blessing. Lord, I'm sick. I need healing. Lord, my family is falling apart. God, please do something to fix my family, my marriage, my kids, whatever. Lord, I need this. Lord, please, can you not see? And we say, God, help. And he's asking us first, do you really want change? Do you really want something different? Seems like an odd question, but it's actually a real question because here's an interesting story. A lot of times people don't really want change, they just want attention. They really don't want change because change is difficult. They don't want things to be better. They've accepted that this is how life is, and they just kind of like it this way. And if I let God do anything in my life, then I don't know what that means. I want to use the word, do we become comfortable in our circumstance? And Jesus says, so before anything happens in your world, before you come to me and you cry out, I'm going to ask you a straight up question. Do you want me to change your life? Over the years as a pastor, I've met with I don't even know how many people at various stages of life. I've led, had the opportunity to pray with people and show them in Scripture how to accept Christ, and I've been there when they've asked Christ in their heart. And rarely, I'm not making a general statement. I guess I am kind of making a general statement, but rarely is that not connected with some life crisis. There's usually a life crisis going on, and it's all different kinds of life crises that hit us, and we're at the end of our rope, and life that we've been doing isn't working, and we want something different, and we cry out and we say, Lord, I need you to change my life, and I want you to be my Lord and Savior. That's really kind of how it works, isn't it? When you get to the place where you realize that you're lost and your life is really messed up and you need Jesus, it's a crisis that drives us there. Now, here's the issue. Too often, we just want saved from the crisis. We don't really want life to be different. I don't want to have to change my lifestyle. I don't want to have to change my friends. I don't want to have to change my job. I don't want to have to change the things that I'm doing. I just want this particular crisis to go away. So what we do is we use Jesus, we use the Lord too often as a crisis counselor. Get me through this immediate need and then I'm cool. And I'll go on with life and everything's good. And Jesus is saying, no. He asked this man, if you want to be healed, you need to understand that this is forevermore a life-changing situation. You're going to be able to walk. You're going to have to get a job. Everything's different. And when Jesus comes to us and says, yes, I realize you're a sinner. You realize you're a sinner. That's why you're coming before me. When he says, I want to transform you, he's not talking about I want to save you from this immediate crisis situation. It's not the sickness that I'm worried about. It's not the financial implosion that I'm concerned about. It's not the relationship struggles. That's not that side. What I want to change is you. I want to change you, not your circumstance. Your circumstance will change when you change. When you start making better decisions. When you start living your life for the Lord, not for yourself. When you start putting Jesus first and the kingdom of heaven first, then circumstances begin to change. So I'm going to ask us, not you, I'm asking us this morning, do we want Jesus to change our life? Do we really want a different life? Because that means change. It means transformation. It means that old things have to pass away. Attitudes, whatever, circumstances, situations, we have to be willing to let that go. If I want Jesus to change me, if I want to be healed from the inside out, then I have to be willing to lay the rest of it down. That's where the hard part is. That's why I asked him first, do you want to be healed? We all like the idea of Jesus being our Lord, right? And I like to say this. Actually, I think too often, we prefer Jesus as our Savior. We like Him as our Savior because we don't want to go to hell. So I want Him to be my Savior. Save me from the pit fires of hell, God. I don't want to go there. Anybody with me? That's an amen statement. I don't want you to be my Lord because I want to be in charge. So we just want the Savior part, not the Lord part. Because if you're Lord, then it means that I am subject to you. And that my opinions are under your authority. My life is now yours, not mine. And so the struggle for us is real as humans because we are control freaks. And we want to say, well, I want Him to be my Savior because I don't want to go to hell. But I still want to live the life I want to live and do the things I want to do and act the way I want to because that's the way I am. And God says, that's not how this works. If you're going to be a new creature, you're going to be a transformed creature. Old things, like I said, pass away. You're new. From this day forward, this man would be a new creature. Life transformed. Not the same. What's your circumstance today? Or what is the thing you're wrestling with? What's the thing that you're fighting with? What are you saying, God, help me with? I'm going to ask you now, are you really willing to let him change you. Second question, and I think it's interesting. It's kind of an implied question. Do you want to be healed? Yes. Well then, get up. It's not really as much a question as it is a command, but it's an implied question. If you really want to be healed, do you believe it's possible? Do you have faith? Do you have the faith that you're healed? Do you have the faith that your marriage can be better? Do you have the faith that your finances can be better? Do you have faith that your life can be better? Do you? Then get up. Take up your bed and walk. You realize he's asking him to do the impossible? Why is he there? His legs don't work. He's an invalid. He can't walk. He can't stand up. He's dependent upon people carrying him. He's dependent on his elbows crawling. He can't physically stand up. He says, do you want to be healed? Then stand up. Get up. Well, that's not fair, Jesus. You want to be changed? Then drop this. Do you want to be healed? Then stop doing this and do this. That's not fair. I can't. Anybody ever say that? Lord's asking me, and I really want to, but I just can't give up. Fill in the blank. You see, the question is, are you willing and do you trust me? Because the bottom line comes down, do we trust Jesus to change us or not? Do we really believe that he can? Do you think he can make your life better? Do you think he can take things and transform them, and like Paul said in Romans, cause all this stuff to work for the good in your life? Do you believe that's true? Then in faith, he's saying, then move. Faith without action is dead. It's not true faith. Faith is an action word. It means that I am moving. So when he says, okay, you say you're willing, prove it. So he says to us, you say you're willing to change your life. You want me to change your life. You want me to take away these things that are holding you down, these barriers, these things in your life, the relationship issue. I'm just filling in blanks. We all got them, right? There's a plethora of things that surround us and choke us down in our life. And he says, you say you're willing to be changed. Prove it to me. Make a step. Get up. Do something. Do something. I'm going to pick on Sandra for a minute. She's had 2 weeks of free. This is an amazing, awesome year for us. The 12th, she reports to her new school at Happy. If you don't know that, we're happy that she's at Happy. She's going from 135 kids a day to 45 kids a day. She's going to no Amarillo construction traffic to the Happy Highway. So she can get in her car and drive happy, all the way to happy, and return from happy, on the happy highway, all the way home. We're looking for a happy year. We're looking for happy. Okay, but here's the deal, and I'm not really picking on her. This is just an example, and we've walked through this. As many of you all know, you've prayed with us for years that she was at a particular school in Amarillo, and it was a tough school. It's a hard school. They go through principals and there's no discipline, and it is in the roughest part of town, and she's been there 12 years. And we kept saying, Lord, open the door. Lord, open the door. Lord, open the door. And she, how many years have we said, have you told me? I'm not going back. 11 of them. I'm not going back. I'm not going back. I can't do it anymore. 11 times she said, I'm not going back. I can't do it anymore. I can't deal with it anymore. But she kept going back. And finally this year we said, you know what? We're asking God to open the door, but we're not looking for doors that are open. We're not moving. So she did something unusual. She got on the internet and started looking at job openings and started sending out resumes. She got a call from Happy while we were on vacation in Colorado the last time. We wanted a change, right? But were we willing to get up and take up our bed and walk? Or did we just want to sit on our bed and say, God help, God, please move. God, please do something. God, do something. Please change this. And he says, change what? You're still sitting on your bed. Get up and change will happen. Get up and change happens. Pick up your bed. Stuff happens. When we step out in faith, do we believe Jesus can literally, not figuratively, literally change our life? Then let's get up. Let's make better decisions. We know what's hindering us. Put it down. Question, are you willing? Second question, do you trust him? Is he able? Do you have faith? Jesus wants us to believe that he'll bless us. Jesus wants us to believe that he can change our life. Jesus desires us to walk in faith, trusting in him every step of our life, knowing that his plan is the right plan. Even when we can't see what's going on, when we have no idea what this looks like. And I'm going to tell you, it is hard to turn loose of things we've become comfortable with. It becomes hard to turn loose of things that we've made our own. And we're not willing to do anything else or expand anywhere else because, God, this is my little domain, this is my little world, and this is where I'm staying. And if I don't get to do what I want to do, I'm not, it's like the man said, if I can't just sit here, I'm not going to do anything until Jesus said, get up. Get up. Take up your bed. Ask to do the impossible. You ever feel like God asks you to do some things that are impossible? You know why he asked that? Because all things are possible with God. We look at it as impossible. God looks at it as, pff. I don't know if God goes, pff, but he should, because pff is the correct answer. Because he said, let there be light. Pfft. Let there be grass. Pfft. Jesus got up in the boat, said, storm, be still. Pfft. What we think is impossible, God goes, you have no concept of impossible. Nothing is impossible. Do you want to be who God wants you to be? Do you want to be the person that God created you to be? Do you want to have the life that God designed you to have? You say it's impossible. God can do it. Do you trust him? But you won't know the life that God wants you to have until you take up your bed. You get up, fold it up, and you walk away. What's involved in this is, will you be obedient? Not only do you trust me, but will you be obedient? Will you do it? A lot of times it's easy to say, I want change, and I know that God can, but I don't want to be obedient. Because the man, what did he do? It says, immediately. Right then. Instantly. Jesus said, hey, get up, take up your bed. And the scripture says, and immediately, the man got up. Obedience. But then it's even more interesting. You go through the passage and it says, later, you know, you get to that who healed you, all of that stuff. That's a sermon for another day. I ain't going to worry about the Pharisees. I'm looking at what Jesus did with this man. He finds him in the temple and he says, see, you're well. Sometimes we need to just let Jesus find us again and go, see, you're a different person than you used to be. See the changes I've made? See the difference in you? Now do you see? Sometimes we don't see it because we're in the middle of it. But have you ever looked back 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 10 years and go, wow, what a difference God has made in my life. See, you're different now. But then he gives him an interesting warning. Continue in obedience. Now, sin no more. Don't return back to it. Or something worse will happen. Well, what's worse than being paralyzed all your life? Dead? It's an option, right? paralyzed and blind. He says, see to it that you sin no more. So when the transformation, I believe he can change me. I want him to. I believe he can. I let him. But then I have to walk in it. I have to be obedient. Let me ask you a straight up hard question. God ever set you free from something that you turned around and went back to? God ever set you free from something, situation in your life, and he gave you complete freedom from it, and you walked away, and then you just turned around and went back? I believe the scripture says, like a dog returns to its vomit. Well, that's a pretty picture. But it's true, isn't it? The reason that we end up going through this cycle and the Lord sets us free and we're liberated from whatever, and then we go back and we keep sliding backwards and we find ourselves, and you ever get in that cyclical thing where you're on top for a while and you're all about Jesus, and then you're down at the bottom, you don't think about Jesus, and you're all on top again, you're all about Jesus, and then you fall off and you're down here and you're not thinking about Jesus, and life is just like it was. Do you know why? Obedience is required to stay up here. He says, now don't sin anymore. Interesting. What did he say to the woman caught in adultery? You know, they were accusing her, and he said, okay, now if you have no sin, then cast the first stone. Everybody walked away. He says, where are your accusers? Well, they've all gone away. And he says, neither do I condemn you. Now we got that all clear. Go and sin no more. Don't do this anymore. What's he talking about? Obedience. Say that word with me. Obedience. Boy, it comes off like sandpaper, doesn't it? Because we don't like obedience. One more time. Obedience. If you want Jesus to transform your world, are you willing? Really? Do you really want change? Or do you just want to gripe about your life? Two. Do you believe he can change it? And will you get up and do something about it? Will you walk away from what's holding you there? That bed was comfortable. He'd been on it 38 years. That was his safety spot. Will you walk away from your comfortable spot and let him do something in your world? Three, will you walk in obedience? Will you stay there? There's one last implied question, and it's really more of what he does. And it's implied for us. Verse 15. They asked him all about it. Jesus found him in verse 14, said, see, you're well, sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you. Verse 15. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who'd healed him. How important is it to share what Jesus does in our life? To give the credit where it goes, not to self-help, not to hard work, not to self-determination. No, we know better than that, right? You and I, our best self-determination is at best. It says, he immediately went and told the Jews who it was. How is it that you're walking, Jesus? How is it that your life is different today? Man, your life is, I look back where you were 7, 8, 10, whatever years ago, and I see your life is different. How is it, Jesus? He gave credit where credit was due. He went and talked. Jesus does something, and too often, we don't see it, we forget it, we go on without saying anything about it. We just roll with it. What a shame. Do you know why? How many others that had spent all these years at the Pool of Bethesda with this man were challenged? Don't know. Scripture doesn't say. One of the things I want to point out to you, if you don't do it now, but if you'll turn over into the end of the book of John, he says, I'm not quoting, I'm going to tell you what it says roughly. Jesus did many, many, many more things than what are written down here. What we get is a sample of the amazing, miraculous, life-changing things that Jesus did in 3.5 years on earth, things that he did in his 33-year lifespan. In fact, John says, I suppose if everything miraculous that Jesus had been recorded, there would not be enough books to hold it. We often look at the Gospels and think, well, Jesus only did this and he only did... No, we get a little minuscule picture of the vastness of the lives that Jesus transformed and the miraculous things, the things that Jesus did. We only see a little piece of it. All of these things that he did changed somebody's life. Now, here's a question. How many of you all, and this is going, I don't know how this is going to work. How many of y'all are here today because somebody invited you at some point to come to church here? I invited Sandra, and Sandra invited me when we started it. You're here because some family member or whatever. How many of y'all just drove by one and they go, oh, church? Okay. So, you know. The truth of the matter is that 80% of people that are attending any church at any time, 80% of the people there are there because somebody invited them to come. Here's another statistic. 90% of the people that receive Jesus Christ as their Savior do so because a personal invitation from someone, a testimony, and a sharing of their faith took place in their life. Over the years that we've been here, how many years have we been here? Golly, 13 years? I think I've only had 3 people that have ever accepted Christ as their Savior during a worship service, at the end of a preaching service. 3. I don't know how many, meet me later that week, call me, meet in the parking lot, meet at the coffee shop, wherever, and I get to share one-on-one. Do you know that the most important thing that you can do as a child of God is give honor to God? To testify the transformation in your life? You say, I don't know how to witness. I don't know. No. Just tell me this, what Jesus do in your world? All a testimony is what's Jesus done for you. This guy didn't have much of a testimony, did he? I don't know. I was crippled 38 years. He said, get up. I got up. Who did it? Jesus. How powerful is that? There is nothing more powerful than the name of Jesus. So the question is, do we tell others? Are we sharing who Jesus is and what he's done? If not, why? Why not? We're not here today because we're great people or we're good at anything. We're here today because Jesus Christ died on a cross to transform you and I into the image and his likeness. He died that we can be redeemed. Jesus asks us the question, do you want to be different? You want your life to be different? Do you want things to change? Do you want me to rock your world? Quote Jesus. Then get up. Have faith. Get up. Move. Change. Do something. And then continue to do something. Be obedient to continuing to do something different. Don't fall back into the same hole, the same rut, the same slime pit that he just pulled you up out of. Don't go back there. Don't be that dog. And you know how we stay out? Testify. You know what keeps us on top? Accountability, because we tell somebody else what Jesus has done for us. Now we're accountable to let him continue to do that, right? How many of y'all want to be a bad witness? I don't remember which one of the famous preachers it was, Moody or whoever it was back in the day. I read this, and I'm assuming it's true. It was pre-internet when I read it, so I know it's true. It was in a book. Gets on a passenger train. He's in, I think it was in Chicago, and he's going to do a revival. He was a tremendous evangelist a century ago. And a guy is sitting on the train, and I think it was Moody. Moody comes walking on the train, And the guy goes, "Hey, this is Dwight Moody." He said he was so inebriated he could barely talk. He said, "I'm one of your converts." Moody goes, "Apparently you are one of my converts and not one of Jesus's." How much truth is in that statement? Because if I help you change, it's going to be short-lived and a big burn at the end. But if Jesus transforms you, it's life-changing. And you can testify that Jesus changed your world. Question. We want different. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the day. I thank you for the question that you asked this man. Though it seems strange that you would ask a lame man if he wanted to be healed, I understand the depth of the question. Because the truth is, Lord, that I may not be lame in my legs, but I'm paralyzed in other ways in my life. And I live in fear and circumstances that are detrimental to me and my family and my friends. And you say, you don't have to do that. So the question comes to us today. It may be the question of the person that's never even asked you into their heart, that have never become a believer in you. Lord, the first question is, do you want your life to be different? Or are you okay on this road of peril that you're bouncing down in a flaming wagon? Do you want to stay that way? So my question, Lord, is this. Will you send the Holy Spirit on us right now that we'll face the truth of the question? And the Holy Spirit that comes into our heart and our mind and routs out all of the stuff and drags all of our junk out in front of us and lays it out before us and says, is this what you want to hold on to? Or do you want change? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to hold on to this? Or do you want new? So Lord, today, here we are. As I've asked for the Holy Spirit to move in our heart, now I'm going to speak to us. You've got something that you're holding on to. Your paralytic bed, the mat that you've become comfortable in. And you'd like to not be tied to it, but not enough to do anything about it. So today, will you answer the first question? Do you really want your life to be different? And if you answer yes, then we move to the second question. Do you believe Jesus can do it? Do you really believe that Jesus can break the chain, the bond of whatever it is that's held you for all these years? Do you believe He's powerful? The answer is yes. Then I move to the next question. Will you move? Will you obey Him when He says, get up? I don't know what you're dealing with. You do. God does. So let's lay it out before Him today. And if nothing else comes of this today, God, we can no longer stand before You and say, well, I didn't have an option. That's just who I was. That was just the hand I was dealt. That's just the life I had, because You said, no. I come to give you an abundant life. I come to give you a new life. You have the ability today to transform your world through the power of Jesus Christ. So if you stay on your paralytic mat, waiting on the angel to stir the waters, it's because you choose to. But today, the Lord says, do you want to be healed? Will you heed? In Jesus' name, amen.